This is the Invincible podcast on TV Podcast Industries. We're talking about Invincible Season 2, Part 2, Episode 5. This must come as a shock.
We've completed a ship to take you home. You can return to your planet and your center for learning and drink.
Thanks, but I can't go yet. There's still so much to do.
The city will be whole again soon. Your people must need your strength.
There's tons of heroes on Earth. I'm sure they got it covered.
Oh, the might of omnipotence! Tremble before my unlimited power!
No.
I'm sure you know your planet best.
Welcome back, fellow Guardians, to the Invincible podcast on TV Podcast Industries. Oh, it's been a while, but we're back talking about Invincible Season 2, Episode 5. This must come as a shock. I'm one of your hosts, Derek.
And this must come as a shock. I am Chris.
Welcome back, Chris.
Welcome back, Derek. We were both on hiatus. Well, the show was on hiatus. We were not.
Yes.
We were busy podcasting many, many, many other shows.
Yes, we were. Yes, we were. We've been podcasting about Shogun, the epic historical drama. And we've been podcasting about another animated show, Star Wars The Bad Batch, but a very different audience for that show.
Yes. As award-winning and worthy to be discussed, but definitely less... Viscera?
Yeah.
We'll call it Viscera. Definitely that's Viscera.
I don't think I've seen blood in three seasons of that show. So, yeah, I don't think it's the same audience at all. But we talked about it before we left part one of Invincible Season 2, Chris, about, you know, whether this hiatus was a good thing or not. Now, looking back on it, Invincible has been everywhere since season one, part one finished. I'm gonna stop saying that, but yeah, since that finished a couple of months ago, it's been everywhere. It's got its own video game. The Adam Eve video game came out on PC. It has a mobile game, the Guarding the Globe, the Invincible mobile game, and now loads of the characters in Fortnite as of this week.
Yep. No, like literally. So this is the. Very much the building that we've seen for this brand. It sounds terrible to put like that, but the fandom is growing.
Yes.
Like over, it's like The Boys.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember The Boys has just continued to grow and grow and grow in
Absolutely.
The audience? I would say somewhat the same as The Rings of Power, but that already had like 20 million films. that was the length of time it felt watching.
I forgot. I always forget you're not a fan of Lord of the Rings.
Yeah. No, it had like, they've had this slow, I don't want to call it a slow burn, but each series has just brought in a new group of kind of viewers and kind of fans. And then Skybound Entertainment have been, when they really kind of doubled down, they said, okay, well, we're going to start making games. We're going to start making additional kind of, I forget what the way they coin it, but it's like multi-touch point media.
Right, right.
Something really weird. Where it's
something
like,
PR speaky, yeah.
Yeah, it's very PR speaky business. It's like, we're going to synergize the overall like population and bring them together so that they... Anyway, basically, the way they expressed it when they kind of came out with Skybound was this, hey, we have our properties, mm-hmm. one of which is Invincible, and we're going to put it in the right places at the right time.
Yeah, yeah.
So this was done similar by Marvel Games, Bill Roseman over there, where he went... I'm going to give the best of my properties on comics to the best video game developers. Mm-hmm. And that's where you get Marvel Spider-Man and things like that.
Yeah.
Versus, say, other DC properties that have not been as good on video games.
Talking about Suicide Squad there, aren't you, Chris?
Who knows? Anyway,
yeah.
Back to Invincible.
Yeah.
They've just planned it beautifully. Is it actually also back sooner than we thought?
Mm-hmm.
Back when we were having our discussions, we were thinking, later in 2024.
Yeah, we thought June. Yep. Yeah. Which is the spot taken up by the boys. Season 4 is going to be out in June instead. So as you may know, if you're listening to us on the podcast feed dedicated to Invincible, we combine Invincible and the boys as those shows tend to alternate on Prime Video. So so it's interesting that that we're going to have, I guess, those two swapped effectively. We don't have to wait as long as we thought they were going to. But all this to say, I haven't felt like I've been missing Invincible as much as I thought I was going to, because I've been able to play all of those things, except for Fortnite. I haven't played that yet. But I've been able to play with the characters and learn more about them just by the video games, which has been great fun.
Yeah, and for me, I've just kind of continued my reread. I pop in and out and then go back a couple of chapters and then jump back in. And it's very much like my Wheel of Time reread.
Right. It'll never stop.
It will never stop, and it will just continue on forever and ever. Good. Much like this introduction.
Well, welcome back once again, fellow Guardians. Just a reminder, if you haven't subscribed to the podcast, you can subscribe to the podcast over on our website at tvpodcastindustries.com. We are lucky enough to be recording these podcasts ahead of the release of Invincible, but we do want to hear your thoughts about every episode of the show. Lots and lots going on. So please email us in with your thoughts to feedback@tvpodcastindustries.com, or pop on over to our Facebook group at facebook.com/groups/TV Podcast Industries. There is a spoiler post up there for each episode as it's released, and we'll discuss your feedback on the next episode of the podcast. But we do have a little bit of feedback coming to us after the Atom Eve special, which was our last Invincible podcast, Chris. Meryl Smith sent in an email to us who said, "Well, I recently read the comic that the Atom Eve special was based on and was surprised to learn that it was actually an origin for both Atom Eve and Rexplode. I mean, I finally get why Rex is Rex, and I kind of want to see them do a special on him too, maybe even other characters in the Invincible verse. So what do you think, Chris? What would be your choices for other characters that could get spin-off movies?"
The Immortal.
Mm-hmm.
He's essentially the Vandal Savage, if you know your DC lore. Mm. He's that. He's like a man who's just lived for... ever. He's immortal.
Mm-hmm. Thousands of years, like, of story to tell there with the Immortal. I think one of the things with the show so far, and we mentioned it before, that the Guardians of the Globe unusually don't get much focus in the show. We have some very small bits of them, you know, chatting with each other for 5 minutes of an episode, but we don't really get their backstories. So as we said, the Atom Eve special was great to get much more of a focus on Atom Eve. So maybe we'll get a focus on some of the other Guardians in the future. I can see them doing it. I can see them doing off-season specials for many of the characters in the show. It'd be great to get more backstory on them.
There is a point in what I assume might come later this season, which happens to Monster Girl and Robot.
Mm-hmm.
And there might be a really good story there where you can combine it with their, we know their origins to a degree, but they can go to their origins and then this other thing, storyline, where they are forced together for a long period of time. That would be a good one, because I think everyone would enjoy that, especially because we see, in the last part of the season, we did see Robot and Monster Girl kind of flirtatiously talking.
Going out on their date, Chris. We saw their little date. It was lovely. It's really cute. Good stuff. Thanks so much for that feedback, Meryl. Really good to hear your thoughts on the Atom Eve special. Hopefully we'll hear from you throughout the second half of Invincible. But let's get into it, Chris. Let's get into our discussion of Invincible 205. This must come as a shock. Of course, once again, a reminder, Invincible is created by Robert Kirkman, Cory Walker, and Ryan Ottley. This episode was written by Helen, Leigh, who wrote episode 204, and of course, the Atom Eve special, which was the last two Invincible things that we covered on this here podcast. This episode was directed by Haylee, Herrick, who directed the Atom Eve special. So interesting that we started with that feedback from Meryl as well, isn't it?
Yeah, no, definitely. Yeah. And you can see some of the connections.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, well, that's just my own opinion, but maybe we can talk through some of them later.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Chris, do you want to give us the synopsis for Invincible 205? This must come as a shock.
Yes, and in my best John impersonation, sure. Mark Grayson comes back to Earth with his half-brother after surviving the Vulturemite attack on Thraxus. He tells his mother, Debbie, about his ordeal and what happened to Omni-Man after he left Earth. Debbie welcomes his half-brother while Mark attempts to reconnect with Amber and William. Mark's boss, Cecil Stedman, the head of the Global Defense Agency, the GDA, is angry at Mark for leaving Earth against his orders. He tells them that the Guardians of the Globe were very nearly killed by a mysterious enemy. Later we see Cecil's assistant, Donald Ferguson, confronting him And he learns that he was turned into a cyborg after he sacrificed his life trying to stop Omni-Man. Donald is awakened from a nightmare and learns that the Sequids, a parasitic alien race that invaded Mars, are heading towards Earth. He recruits the Guardian of the Globes to stop the Sequids. Using Shapeshift Martian knowledge, Robot, Black Samson, Invincible, Monster Girl, the Immortal, and Adam Eve try to take on the Sequids and the possessed astronaut Russ Livingston. Back on Earth, a group of reptilian villains called the Lizard League attack a military base and threaten to blow up major cities. The three remaining Earthbound Guardians, Rexplode, Shrinking Ray, and Duplicate, try to stop them, but they are overwhelmed, and Duplicate and Shrinking Ray are killed by Komodo Dragon. Rexplode kills Komodo Dragon and Iguana, but is surprised by King Lizard, who aims his gun directly at Rex's head. Back out in space, the rest of the Guardians face the Sequids, who swarm them and try to take over their minds. The Guardians are outnumbered and outmatched by the aliens, who plan to use their bodies and powers to conquer Earth. In a mid-credit scene, Alan the Alien is alive, and this time, stronger and better than ever. He was saved by Thaddeus, who reveals he is also a Vultramite, who had rebelled and thinks Invincible could be the key to beating the other Vultramites once and for all.
Excellent stuff. An action-packed episode with, I guess, lots of death and lots of returns that were completely unexpected. What a way to start the second half of the season.
100%. This is just a fun opener that really kind of sets up some good storylines, but also just makes you kind of feel again for these characters straight away.
Yeah.
And does the very much, I was going to call it the boys, but very much just the Amazon thing now, where it doesn't hold back any punches.
Mm-hmm.
Like your heroes are going to die no matter what. So just get used to it. And just like, it's not like, oh no, they're going to die. And then they're back, the standard, they're back 2 minutes later thanks to this. This is very much, nope, you're dead.
You say that, but we do have a big returning character who shouldn't be back after what happened to him last season, which we'll talk about later in our top 5 points from the episode. Let's start with our first point about the episode, the return of Mark Grayson. He's not returning from death, thankfully, but he is beaten to a pulp on the planet Thraxia after the attack from the Vultramites. So he got his mission at the end of last season when they took away Nolan. They told him that he has to replace Nolan on Earth. He has to prepare Earth for the Vultramite Empire. I didn't see very much of that from Mark in this episode. It's not like he arrived back at Earth and made a big speech to the world saying the Vultramite Empire is coming. So I thought that was quite interesting.
Yeah, no, he's going to slowly try and figure out what he can do to defy this order.
Mm-hmm.
The last thing his dad said to him was, read my books.
Mm-hmm.
So he's going to slowly try and figure out what the hell that means.
Yeah.
Because his dad was a travel writer.
Mm-hmm.
So we really need to figure out why. He's like, read my books. Go to the faraway land of Greece. Tell me what it's about.
Yeah.
But yes, no, so it'd be, I think he's going to kind of try and figure out that. And it's, this is the calm before the storm, probably the best way of putting it, I think. It's like, we're just going to get this kind of, here's another story to keep you going. Well, this long story continues on about the Vultramite Empire and the impending invasion.
Yeah, but did you think it was, he seemed quite reluctant to leave Thraxia, though? He helps them out and they fix him up and make sure that he's not on his deathbed anymore, let's say. And then he helps them trying to fix up their city again. Stays there for what seems like a few weeks or months, because all the Thraxians are getting really old now. They age much quicker than people from Earth. But he seemed really reluctant to go back home, even when they were pretty close to finishing. And they say they've built their ship to send him back to Earth. I was wondering whether that's because he doesn't want to take up this this potential new position that he has, that he didn't want to go back to Earth. I know he says, of course I want to see my girlfriend and my mom, but I'm going to stay around here, you know? Or does he just feel the responsibility of what they did to their planet?
I think he's scared. Mm-hmm. I took it that he's at least scared. Again, like, he was beaten to a pulp.
Mm-hmm.
And that he hasn't dealt with that. His dad was nearly killed in front of him, but at least taken away from him.
He got his back broken, didn't he?
Yeah. And like, so I think that will come to play a part, because I think he is going, Yeah, he wasn't enough. They thought himself and his father was going to be enough to stop the Vulturemites, at least there.
Yeah.
And it wasn't. They couldn't do the heroing part of being superheroes. And the Thraxians suffered the consequences.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So yes, part of it also is he probably wants to, he does say, I want to stay and continue like my father did to help you guys.
Mm.
But I'm leaning more into the fear part, but again, I might be applying my own biases against
this. I get it. Yeah, it's either fear or, as I say, once he gets back to Earth, there is a possibility that the Vulturemites could turn up any day and he has to effectively turn over his planet to them as well. So, but there is another kind of big moment on the planet Thraxia where Nolan's wife, Andressa, hands over Mark's half-brother, telling him, as I said, that they're aging out pretty quickly and the poor little kid will be left on his own very soon. We see Noalzat, who's the Thraxian who brought Mark to the planet. We see how old he's becoming. He's talking in this really, really old voice and is looking ancient now. And Andressa seems to have aged quite significantly as well and is saying, you know, they are a planet of ant-like creatures who age much quicker than everybody else. And with Mark and his little brother both being part Vulturemite, they're aging really slowly. They age much slower than humans. I like that little touch where Mark says that's the same worry that Nolan had for me, that everybody around me will die as I get older because I'm not going to age the same as other humans around me. So thought that was interesting that there's that direct connection between the two of them being Vulturemites. And he's now left with the younger brother to take care of.
Yeah. And again, like it was this beautiful speech from Andressa around, I'll be dead before he even learns to talk,
mm-hmm.
before he walks. Generations will pass. And you're like, ooh, yeah, fair mm-hmm. point.
Yeah.
We're thinking it's like a lifespan of a couple of months here.
Yeah, yeah.
I was always in my head kind of going, oh, it's about a year or two. No, it looks like it's a couple of months.
Really? Okay, yeah.
Well, like, if you think of how long Mark has been on Thraxia,
mm-hmm.
it's a couple of, I think when he gets back, it turns out it was a couple of weeks, a month or two.
3 months, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So if he's gone 3 months and you see how fast Andressa has aged,
mm-hmm.
so maybe it's a year,
yeah,
max maybe.
Yeah.
For a generation, but definitely it's not long.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So I do wonder about the mix. And again, this will probably be something that will come up in the show later on. I wonder about the mix of the Vulturemite and the Thraxian people. Does that mean that maybe Mark's half-brother will grow quicker than Mark's growing? Will he suddenly be older looking than Mark? You know, will he catch up to Mark in the future? I wonder about that. Is that something between those two species mixed versus him mixing with a human? So
Will he get mandibles?
Yeah. It's a weird one, isn't it? You know, the fact that Nolan, who is human-like, except he has a moustache, because all Vulturemites have mustaches, he mates with an ant species, and what happens? They have a purple child with no discernible mandibles.
I think it was like purple and purple and pink.
Yeah.
Or blue and pink make purple.
It just changes colours rather than him having any of the species. I guess, what would you say? The dominant genetics are probably Vulturemite. I guess
would be
the
way
that they probably
that genetic kills everything.
exactly. But yes, Mark returns to Earth, bringing his baby brother back with him to Debbie. We see Debbie's gone back to work, which is nice because she had major struggles in the first four episodes of the season. She's gone back to work in the realtor office.
Yep.
I wonder where Paul, who's her boss, who drops her off at home and gives her a bottle of wine, which is from the office for all the great work that you're doing. Is Paul coming on to her?
100%.
I think so.
I took that. I was just like, dude, this is you. This is your employee. This is a HR violation right there.
What did I say? 60-70% of relationships start in the office, Chris?
Oh my God.
You could testify to that, can't you?
Hey. We were not in an office. We were in the same company.
You work for the same company, technically. Yes. Well, three of us work for the same company, Chris. But yes.
But I didn't end up dating and marrying you.
That's true. Much to my chagrin. Yes. but I do like the little gag with the wine. Thought it was really interesting because we saw those first four episodes where Debbie was kind of questioning whether she was becoming a bit of an alcoholic because she was drinking on her own all the time. I love that she goes inside. Mark's been away for a few months and she reaches for the wine glass and then stops goes, okay, well, I'm not going to drink on my own. And then it's Mark and his half-brother arrive, his alien half-brother arrive. And the next time you see her, she has a full glass of wine in front of her, just going, I cannot get through this conversation without a glass of wine.
No. Really to good. Be fair, again, your ex-husband's, yeah, it would be ex-husband's son is there. Your son's stepbrother. Mm-hmm. And now you're being forced to take care of this child?
Absolutely.
Or he's being asked.
And it's not even ex-husband. It's your cheating husband. He left the planet and went off and slept with somebody else and had their child. And now you have to take care of it. Yeah, it's
to be fair, he did try and commit genocide. Like, mm-hmm.
Well, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
We did see that she seems a lot more... Debbie seems a lot more put together in the 3 months since we last saw her. And this has, like, the real at her job is good. Mm-hmm. It's definitely seemed to kind of, and then her also throwing out all of Nolan's stuff, including his books.
Yep.
In the last season. So I think overall it's just, yeah, it's good. I think she was moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
But then boom, a purple grape flavored child arrives to ruin it all.
Absolutely, absolutely. But she is going to take care of him because that's what Mark needs, right? So Mark goes off and reconnects with everybody else. Then he just goes back to his college, meets up with William, who I like. William has taken over the room completely, taken down all of Mark's posters and set up the room as if it's his own. Very quickly ran out of excuses for Mark being away as well. He said he'd cover for him. It's now 3 months later, so poor William ran out of excuses probably after a week or two. So whether Mark even is able to stay in college is in question here, right?
Yeah, William straight away, even like as Mark is leaving the room to get back to go see the missus, he's told, oh, and the dean wants to see you. And Mark goes, well, you're supposed to be covering for me. He goes, you can only cover me for a couple of days, not 3 months. You're going to see like the kind of ramifications, like, will Mark continue to go to college if he's constantly running off into space? It's always that fun to think, like, how did Peter Parker get through high school? Like, does Clark Kent ever do any articles?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, it's always those questions that you have. How many meetings does Bruce Wayne actually do?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Or how many does he fall asleep in, like The Dark Knight?
Yeah, exactly. That he referenced that a bit. I suppose it's one of those ones. How the hell would you hold down a job if you have all this stuff going on? Exactly.
Yeah.
So can Mark go to college if he's constantly going out to space? Because he goes back out into space in this episode as well. So he's back for a couple of days before he's called in to go out into space. Any other things here that we need to talk about? I suppose his meeting back up with Amber as well, his girlfriend, who's starting to make some connections in college. She's got a new group of friends who Mark interrupts when he comes back in. I thought there was a nice little gag there when he says that he was off on another planet, Arium, in the town he was in visiting his cousins when he was away. I thought that was a good little gag. But quite a lot's happened to her in the 3 months as well.
Yeah, and she's continued to move forward. She feels... There's definitely a loneliness
mm-hmm.
that starts to kind of emanate from a lot of her sentences and the tone she starts to pull together. But she has been enjoying the college life. She has her friends, and you see those people in the room. One of those guys, you're like, the one who was sitting cross-legged, you're like, no. You like Amber.
Oh, yeah.
I don't like this. I don't like this kind of what's going on. Yeah, I'm the jealous boyfriend type of people.
Absolutely.
I feel for Mark.
Yeah, there's always that one guy in the group. You know, they even joke that they thought that she was lying about having a boyfriend. So he was hanging around in case she eventually told him that she had no boyfriend. So he could swoop right in there. But we do learn that she had lost her grandfather while Mark was away, and he wasn't there. And she was on her own. So she did feel very lonely during that time. So she's not in a good place either. But this is the thing. She obviously had said in last half of the season that she'll put up with that. That's what she has to do if she's going to be going out with one of the defenders of Earth, right?
Yes. Much like Iron Man said, it's like a suit of armor around the world. Well, now you've got an invincible around the world.
Well, yeah. Yeah, I noticed it again when I was writing my notes for this episode. It must be really difficult for Kirkman when he was writing these stories to not like use the actual name of the character he's satirizing or the group that he's satirizing. You know, it's like, oh, but Global Defense Force, it's really close to what I want to say and what the character I want to use from the comics. It's really close to what I'm writing here, but I'll write something different. I'll write a different name. I wonder, does he ever write the script for the comic books and use the actual DC characters, Marvel characters' names? And then just change them all. Just go find replace.
And you're telling me Darkwing is a completely different character than Batman?
Oh, yeah. That's so different. So different. But that's the return of Mark. That's kind of the big stuff that's happening in this episode, setting us back up for the rest of the season. Because it's obviously a massive thing for the show. The show is Invincible. It's what's happening with him. But lots of other stuff going on in the episode as well. We have the resolution, I guess. Let's go on to our point number two. We have the resolution of what was happening with Donald at the end of last season when he tried to cut into his own arm last season and found metal underneath.
Yes. You were right. He was an android. Well done. I was like, but what if he's just lost an arm? But yes, no, he the resolution is he goes to Cecil, gives out Al, and finds that in the white room, in a different part of the white room, there is a different Donald cyborg body there. Now, his brain was fine. So his brain, he is a cyborg. His brain is inside this metal machine, mechanoid man. Very much like Metallo. Very much like Metallo. again, superhero references.
See, I was thinking again, it's Agent Coulson from the Avengers. It's, you know, Donald looks like Coulson from the Avengers, and now he's having another story of why he's still alive after he thought he was killed. You know, so it feels very Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and
you're telling Agent me Coulson. This is too very close to Tahiti.
Potentially, yes, yes. Okay. I can't remember the timeline of the comics either, but I know you said that this Donald storyline, you couldn't remember much of when it actually originated, so I don't know whether it's very close to when it was on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., but he does remind me very much of Clark Gregg's version of the character. but no, it's really interesting. I think this is something that's going to play out as well. You know, Donald learning this, he's been the faithful sidekick pretty much to Cecil, always doing his bidding. You know, he's questioning now what it means to, you know, effectively the only part of him that still exists is his brain, as you said. All the rest of him is gone.
And I think that's what it's going to be. As you said, like, it's going to continue on. It's like, how can he trust the GDA? How can he trust Cecil?
How can he trust his own body, even, you know?
Yeah. Well, I'm hoping he also gets some cool powers from it.
Absolutely. Well, we know he's stronger than a human. I know we saw that last season. He didn't know why he was able to bend the metal that he had in his hand, I guess. But he does. He is certainly stronger. But if I presume this will start to affect him now that he knows that he's a cyborg.
Yeah. It's funny because I can assume I know exactly where this is going to go. And I think it's very much paint by the numbers in terms of story about, and I don't mean this in a bad way. Let me, in that man finds he's monster. Man gets angry. Man comes to terms with being a monster. Man uses monster abilities to better the world or whatever.
Maybe.
Very much a superhero piece.
Right, yeah.
Like Morbius, the living vampire.
Terrible movie, but good character in the comic books, yeah.
Yes, exactly. It's Morbin time. Jeez. It's 100%, this is still Invincible.
Mm-hmm.
So no matter how paint by numbers it seems, you never really understand, like it may just do that and it may just go take a bit more to the extreme, or it may completely zag when we think they're going to zig.
Of course.
Like, it may just go a complete right and in the next episode he's just going to blow his brains out and that's it. He's like, he can't do it anymore.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So it's interesting. I'm very interested to see where it goes. Mm. Or they could just follow the comic books. But again, I don't know if they're going to do that. They're making some changes in good ways, in unique ways to not just to many of the stories.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just like, yeah, no, show me what you got, Kirkman. Show me what you got.
Absolutely. Let's see how Donald works as a cyborg in the show here. There's two big battle segments for our next 2 points, Chris. We go for the Sequids and what's happening for them for our point number three. Because that kind of brings in Donald. He's the one that calls in the Guardians of the Globe to go and take care of the Sequids who we met back on Mars in season one, right?
Yes. So the Sequids are a slave race to the Martians because they can't, because of the malleable skin and bodies of the Martians, mm-hmm. Who can basically take on any form, they can't get purchased, essentially. Mm-hmm. So back in season one, the astronauts arrive and they go underground, find underground where the Martians are, and the Sequids essentially take over one of the astronauts who is left behind.
Yes, yes.
Left behind, quote unquote.
Well, Russ Livingston, who we saw all the other half of the season as the Martian that had taken his form left his body behind. I love this little joke here where everybody in the entire Guardians of the Globe knows that he's a Martian except for Black Samson, who you see catching him shape-shifting and thinking that he's got this big secret that he's going to be able to tell to the rest of the Guardians, but everybody there already knows. Of course they do, because they wouldn't let him into the group if they didn't know what he was, but they assumed he had good intentions because they'd worked with the Martian before, right, in the previous iteration of the Guardians of the Globe. But I like that they use his information, at least, to understand the Sequids a bit more before going into battle with them.
Yeah, and it's not willingly given. There's a bit of coercion, but they still learn about it. And mm-hmm. we also learn that Russ was hit over the head with a very large mallet.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, wait, how did he trip? We'll deal with that later and then move forward. That's how they get their information. And then we are fast forwarded to everyone on a ship, but not before they get one final member, because Rex Blood comes up with a good idea.
Yeah. Shocker.
Yeah. It is. But that does bring us back to Adam Eve. Like, it gets us back to the end of the Adam Eve special.
Mm-hmm.
It gets us to the end of season two, part one. And she's essentially back at home with her parents, her very abusive parents. And she doesn't want to be a superhero anymore. And it takes Rex, kind of, who we found out he lived with her for a while as well, which was interesting.
Yeah. I only know that from the Adam Eve game, that the two of them were in a relationship for a while. But before that, he was hiding out in her house. So,
yeah. But yes, so we basically, he convinces her that she had... should do this, she needs this.
Mm-hmm.
And she does. She basically joins everyone on the ship as they blast off to adventure.
Mm-hmm.
Off. We do get that very cool scene where he's like, well, you don't even have a gear, like, you can't protect yourself. She just, like, adds on the spacesuit and you're like,
yeah,
it's cool.
That's very cool. That's very cool. She can use her powers to do anything, and sometimes the things that she does actually work and protect people. Which is really useful when they're spaceship explodes pretty quickly after arriving towards the Martian spaceship that's on its way down. And Adam Eve is able to protect them all on their way in. Invincible takes charge pretty quickly as well. The Immortal's supposed to be the leader of the Guardians of the Globe, but it is Mark that quickly says anybody who can fly, push the barrier, I guess, that Adam Eve has created, push it towards the ship so we can get off. And when they get inside, they discover the Sequids are everywhere. They are possibly millions in number.
Yep.
Which is going to be pretty bad for Earth if they arrive.
Yeah, because that's all they want. They just want to take on or take over people.
Mm.
They want that uni mind. They are essentially Starro from the DC comics.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and from the Suicide Squad movie. Yeah.
And the Suicide Squad movie, yes. Mm-hmm. The good one, the James Gunn one, not the other one.
Yes.
Yeah, and it's fun. Like, this is a really cool battle.
Mm-hmm.
Again, you get to see all of the... You see Invincible kind of take that charge. You see Robot step out of his suit to try and figure out the sonic blast.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone's full strength and kind of ability comes out. And then the next important thing is it leaves us on that cliffhanger. Like, we assume the guys are all going to get out of it in the next episode.
Maybe. But
essentially, like, we've seen worse things happen. The only thing I know is this show is called Smash Cut Invincible.
Uh-huh.
So they're not going to kill him off in this next episode.
But I do like
to kill off a load of other characters, though.
Yeah, but I do like the kind of question that it poses. You know, the idea that we have all the Martians who are unable to be possessed, for want of a better word, by the Sequids because they're shapeshifters. There's only one shapeshifter on the team, the Shapesmith, who's on the Garden of the Globe here. Have they just brought a bunch of really strong, super powerful bodies to the Sequids that they could just be possessed and make it even easier to take over Earth and take down their defense force effectively? I really like that, you know, that idea that do you send your most powerful superheroes to take out your villain who could actually turn around and take them back over and make it even harder for Earth to defend against them?
Yeah, so that's why you basically should send your stupid the Z-list team.
Yeah, or
so you should really send them.
Or you send a bomb to blow up the ship that's carrying all the Sequids, right? Rather than sending them on board. True. Yes, that is collateral damage, as they may call it.
Also known as genocide, but good to know. Martian genocide is also known as collateral damage.
Well, it's a ship full of Martians. I didn't actually really understand why all the Martians were on the ship. Why were they there? The Sequids couldn't get control of them. So why were they all aboard the ship? I thought it was just a group of Martians that were there.
They're acting as slaves.
Right. But why?
Yeah.
since they can't be taken over.
Yeah, no, good point. Like, we're going to have to, they're going to talk to the Martians at some point. They'll figure it out. They'll get out and then they'll have a lovely come to Jesus moment with the Martians. Everything's going to be happy. Shapesmith's going to get away. And yeah, it will be grand.
It'll be all good. Let's see how that plays out in the next episode. Because that is a major cliffhanger, and probably the reason why it's a major cliffhanger about who survives or whether the Guardians get taken is because of the other big battle that's going on, which is really our point number four about the Lizard League attack that's going on. So Rexplode, Duplicate, and Shrinking Ray have stayed behind on Earth to protect Earth in case anything happens to the rest of the Guardians, hoping... Asher, it's grand. There's no way there'll be two massive earth-shattering events happening at exactly the same time. And I guess Rex has learned not to say that because that's exactly what happened about two minutes after they order their pizza because they think they're just going to be on chill-out duty for a few days. There's an attack by the Lizard League, who we saw...
We've slowly been seeing grow and change over the course of the last... two seasons.
Well, that's it. Yeah, the Lizard League are kind of like Hydra in Marvel. They're kind of like the Serpent Society as well, obviously, given the Lizard League name. But the difference between them is that as other leaders and their bad leaders and their simple leaders are killed off, someone more powerful seems to rise and take their place, as opposed to it just being, you know, a very similar poorly organized organization. As they get smaller, they seem to get stronger and more and tougher to deal with. So we have Rex and Case and Shrinking Ray have to go and take them out. But it's quite a brutal battle here, where we have, I guess, three of the major characters from the Lizard League, now led by King Lizard, who have infiltrated a military base and are threatening to blow up major cities if they don't get what they want.
Yeah, and that when that battle ensues, it's cool.
It is. It's a great battle. I was going to say
visceral and use all that. I'm just like, no, it is just cool. You see, like, Rex using all his powers. You mm-hmm. see Shrinking Ray using her shrinking abilities.
Yeah.
And literally trying to do a Thanos. Where basically in the end game and Infinity War, everyone said, why doesn't Ant-Man just get really small, go up inside Thanos and kill him from the inside? She attempts to do this. We see why it doesn't work.
it does work on one of them. She's the one that kills Salamander, right? She goes inside his head and explodes it, and thinks she's going to be able to do the same inside the body of Komodo Dragon, who's absolutely massive and is able to squeeze her down inside him and kill her, which is pretty brutal. But instantly, I went back to thoughts because of this podcast. Went back to Emma from Gen V, who hopped inside the brain of one of the security guards back in Gen V and was able to do this, just explode his brain from the inside out. So that's what it made me think of, rather than the Thanos memes at the time. So I was going, wow, they're really just connecting these properties even more now with Gen V and Invincible, seeing this violent breakout from inside. But then we have Duplicate.
Yeah.
Yeah, so not only do we lose Shrinking Ray, we lose Duplicate. And, you know, one of the things we learnt in the last half of the season was that it is actually a case duplicate that dies every single time. It's not just her creating clones and them not having any impact on her. It's a full duplication of her, so she feels every single death. And here, in this battle with Komodo Dragon, she's created probably 10 or 20 different versions of herself who are all being killed instantly. I absolutely had to pause it to see if they have a way out here, and definitely saw the number one on the final version of Duplicate's body, I guess, just before Komodo Dragon smashes those last two pieces together against each other. So, yeah, looks like Duplicate has been absolutely crushed by Komodo Dragon.
Yes, and we can assume that her brother is going to be very angry, because her brother, we've seen him in prison.
Mm.
He has the exact same power set, but is a bit evil. So,
he was in the GDA, wasn't he?
Yes.
He was in their prisons. Ooh, interesting.
And obviously, more importantly, a Duplicate is going out with the Immortal.
Mm-hmm.
So how is he going to deal with this?
Yeah.
If he survives, obviously, if he's getting drunk.
Exactly. And probably because of this scene, I have no idea who is going to survive, except that he is called the Immortal and has survived quite a lot in the first two seasons so far. So he's likely to be the one that will survive. It might take him a while to pull his body parts back together. But then again, maybe he's going to be controlled by one of the Sequids. So it doesn't matter whether he survives or not. He could be possessed. So he may be survived and not know what's going on. So, but it is pretty, pretty awful to see what happens to Kate, especially with that knowledge that she feels all of those deaths as well.
Yes.
So, but nothing else is going to happen to Komodo Dragon, because, Rex does get a shot in and is able to blow up his head after losing his hand, which Komodo Dragon bites off in front of him. That's, also quite brutal.
Yeah. And then just, Rex takes a beating.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, again, why I use visceral a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I know when I talk about these shows. But it's just very much, it's the blood and gore aspect.
Yeah.
Because they really do go in for, they go in for it.
Yes,
and it's only, it's only the Amazon, the boys, Gen V that I've really seen go this hard.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're like, yeah, no. If someone bit your hand off up to kind of your mid arm,
mm-hmm.
yeah, it's gonna bleed a lot and it's gonna not be great.
Absolutely.
But yeah, you're not gonna notice a prince king come up behind you with a gun.
Yes, exactly. But he also takes out Iguana as well, doesn't he? He takes her out, who's been battling with Rex. So he does get to take out two of them, and Salamander was taken out as well. But I like that King Lizard is able to be in the shadows here, and he calls it out. He's like, you know, you're very brave, Rex, but, you know, who survives here? The one that's brave, or the one that waits until the brave person has lost all of their abilities and is down to their last, and then comes out with a gun pointed at their head? So am I the winner here because I just waited, basically? I kind of like that. It seems much smarter than I thought he was going to be. Because when we saw his introduction last season, he kind of came in and shot the former leader of the Lizard League in the head
and took
the team over, and he just had this really slimy voice, and we didn't really know that he was going to be this really, you know, smart tactical genius almost. You know, I don't know whether it's tactical genius to just sit back and wait to tirate your opponent, but it's smarter than running in and getting your head blown off.
It's the Lex Luthor approach.
Yeah.
It's just kind of, I'm going to let other people do my evil deeds.
Exactly, exactly. But at least in this place here, there's an out, right? We see him with a gun to the head of Rex. He's about to pull the trigger, but he doesn't. It cuts back to the other scenes we talked about in space. So Rex, right now, as the end of the episode, Rex is alive because someone could come in and help him out. There are other heroes on Earth, apparently, who could arrive.
Not many.
Maybe the GDA arrived just in time to stop King Lizard from shooting him. So
I'd love if the spaceship from Mars comes in and just like takes him out. It just has a point on it. It's like, whew, and it's just a big kind of spike. And it's like, oops.
Maybe that.
Yeah, maybe that's it. Probably not. Yeah. But speaking of people surviving, our next and final point is the bigger and better introduction or reintroduction of Alan.
Yes. These post-credits or these mid-credit scenes are getting shorter and shorter to have to wait for. It's like, you know, one note of music after the screen goes black and then, wow, here we are in the mid-credit scene. You know, it's almost instantaneous now. But yes, Alan is alive. This I was really surprised about. I knew loads of Invincible fans are massive fans of Alan the character. And having Seth Rogen play him in the show is a fan favorite, let's say. But I kind of didn't expect him back, because that happens with comic books, especially something like Invincible. Some characters that are big fan favorites only get 5 issues in comic books sometimes, you know, and that's what I thought was happening with Alan here. What we learn is that he was saved by Thaddeus, who learned a little bit more about him as well in a second. But what we learn is Thaddeus gambled on the fact that Alan, who was created to fight the Viltrumites, if he isn't on life support and has to fight back and his body has to fight back, that he will get stronger and better. And it turns out Thaddeus is right.
Yep. And it's cool. I can't say much. I knew. I've read the comic books.
Yeah.
I knew Alan survived. And I knew this part about him.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the fun thing. It's kind of hinted at in his origin story when he talks about that, how he kind of was in the tank and he grew stronger and stronger each day. And even when he got out of the tank, he got stronger and stronger.
Yeah. But here he kind of has his Steve Rogers moment where he comes out and he's like massively stacked in comparison to what he was like the last time. He suddenly got, you know, massive abs and huge arms. So he's ready to go and fight. So, but an interesting one, because we thought we were, you know, wondering, or I was wondering about Thaddeus and whether he was against the coalition of planets who were supposed to be battling against the Viltrumite Empire. Here we see him rip off that stupid looking beard that he has, and oh my god, the mustache underneath is real, which must mean he's a Viltrumite. So, but no, he's a rebel Viltrumite. He's someone that turned against the Viltrumite Empire. So I guess their undercover disguise when they're away from the Viltrumite Empire is to get a beard.
Yeah, and it's not even a full beard. It's like, it's everything bar the mustache, because that's real. So I, like, in my head, I've always had that fear. Remember that thing, those fake beards you could get that had the, like, 2 hooks that go over your ears?
Yeah.
It was kind of like that, but minus mustache.
Exactly. Like, exactly. I kind of like this. I do wonder about the mustache thing. Is that, you know, a joke on the Superman thing that he can't shave because it would grow back instantly, or it's impossible to shave the mustache because he's so powerful and the Viltrumites are very similar, of course, to Superman.
That makes more sense. I just took it as they're all evil, so they have mustache like Hitler.
Well, actually, we talked about it last season. I know it's been quite a while, Chris, but actually it's because both Ryan Ottley and Robert Kirkman's dad both had mustaches. So that's why they have mustaches. But I wonder if in the story that the Viltrumites have mustaches because they can't shave them. They're too powerful. So maybe
I don't know. But I'm gonna wait to see Mark with mustache. Gonna be
There you go.
He'll definitely have a hipster mustache.
I'm sure it will. But it is really nice to see Alan back. Very cool here. And I do like Seth Rogen's version of Alan as he's talking to himself, wondering what the hell is going on here. I think that stoner voice works quite well for Alan waking up from what he thinks was his death and seeing his own eyeball float in front of his body last time he was alive.
But he looks, you just made me think about it now, that he does. Seth Rogen really has this just perfect voice for this character,
mm-hmm.
because he does make those jokes when he gets out and he says he has the Captain America Steve Rogers bit. He's like, whoa, look, look, oh my God, I've just destroyed, oh, I'm so sorry, I destroyed your machine. Oh, exactly. God. It's just that stoner, like, oops, I broke this thing. Oops, uh-huh. I broke this other thing. Sorry, just all came flooding back to me there.
Excellent.
Yeah, yep. That definitely gave me a few giggles.
He works quite well. He works really well. Anything else on the episode, Chris, that you want to talk about?
Nothing at this point. What about yourself?
I just wanted to call out the little jokey nods that they gave to Zachary Quinto in here. When Robot's going up into space, Invincible asks him, can they not just raise the shields? And he goes, but this isn't Star Trek, kid. Of course we don't have shields. A nice little nod, because Zachary Quinto played Spock in the J.J. Abrams Star Trek movies. So I like that they gave him a line about Star Trek in there.
Yes, it was a good one.
Yeah.
You have to get, if you're going to bring it, you're going to bring all the fandoms together.
Yeah, exactly.
Make a Star Wars one next.
Well, you got to have a little joke for the character playing Spock, yes. One of the biggest characters in Star Trek. He has to have a little Star Trek joke in there. But yourself, Chris, what do you think overall on the episode?
I loved it. Mm-hmm. I'm so happy it's back.
Nice to be back.
I know it's a short kind of part two seasons, four episodes, but if they're all as good as this, I will go back and rewatch the first season and bring myself all the way back up to the end of this season when this is over. It's fun. It sets it up well. There's still, even though I remember so much of the origin stories and everything about this show, it's still fun to kind of how they bring us back to this and what it is. So, yeah. Overall, absolutely loved this episode. What about yourself? Final thoughts on this episode?
I really like this. I think, you know, the fact that Mark had been backed into a corner at the end of the last season, and then this episode we see him getting back to Earth reluctantly, I think, before he gets back to Earth. But I like that things continue on while he's gone, but not in the right way. You know, the relationship he has with Cecil, for example, where Cecil's really angry at him for leaving the Earth undefended, and Mark doesn't tell him what's really happened. He kind of hears that Cecil has been monitoring Debbie's house, getting all this information, but Mark never once offers up, hang on a second, the Viltrumite Empire are going to come and attack, and I've been given this mission that I'm supposed to be preparing the planet for it, you know, because they don't have that relationship. He hasn't prepared them at all for this possible attack that's coming. So I kind of thought that was really interesting to see that and see more of the Guardians of the Globe, see what they were like when Mark wasn't there. There's an interesting cutaway, and I think I used it as the sample for the opening of the episode. There's an interesting cutaway where we see loads of heroes, not just the Guardians that we know, being attacked by Immortus, this character who's saying he's ultra powerful, and that's going on while Mark's away. But there's loads of other heroes there at that point, and there's not that many of them left. So I wonder, did Immortus kill a couple of characters off screen that we don't know about? Because Cecil seemed pretty annoyed at Mark for being away.
There's definitely a few deaths, I think.
Yeah, but that's the thing about this episode as well. You know, there's some deaths of some major characters here. Duplicate was a massive character. We saw loads of her and learnt lots about her over the course of this last season and a half. So seeing her die, seeing Shrinking Ray die when you didn't think she was going to as well. And potentially we also have Rexplode going to get a bullet in the brain at the start of the next episode. And we have all of our other characters up in space. You know, the only thing protecting them from the Sequids taking over was Adam Eve. And she's lost her power by the end of the episode. She's lost the protection that she has. So some really interesting kickoffs for an episode which is midway through the season but carrying on directly from the first half of the season, so they don't have to reestablish anything and just go straight for all of the action, which they did in spades, and I really enjoyed it. I can't wait for next week's episode.
Well, we don't have to wait long. As you said, it's next week because we are back to weekly episodes on this one.
Mm-hmm. Fun. Yep, one episode a week for the next 4 weeks. Next week is Invincible Season 2, Episode 6, It's Not That Simple, which we're really looking forward to podcasting about. Thanks so much for joining us for this episode. If you want to send in your thoughts again, please email us to feedback@tvpodcastindustries.com or pop on over to our Facebook group at facebook.com/groups/TV Podcast Industries. Share your thoughts, listen along with us every week, and we can't wait to talk to you more about Invincible.
Yes, And if you're enjoying Invincible and like listening to our dulcet tones, why not head on over to patreon.com/TV Podcast Industries, where you can support us for any ongoing monthly amount. Or want to do a one-off donation because you just like this episode, why not head over to buymeacoffee.com/TVPI and keep our editor-in-chief in caffeine as he toils away the wee hours editing these episodes. If you're enjoying animation, don't forget we're also covering the final season of Star Wars The Bad Batch at the moment, which is out each and every week. You've got a few to catch up on.
I was telling Chris this week how much I need my coffee while I'm editing, because I actually edited one of our Shogun podcasts twice. I edited it and then went back to it afterwards when I was putting in the feedback and thought I hadn't edited, went through the whole thing again and did an extra pass, which took me an extra hour, as it always does. So thank you to those of you that have been supporting us, because it's been keeping me in coffee while doing all of my toiling away on the podcast. So thank you so much to all of you that support us over on Patreon or on Buy Me a Coffee.
But other than that, thanks so much for joining us. Keep watching, keep listening, and keep being invincible.
Thanks so much for joining us. Talk to you again next time.
Bye.